Vanuit een winderig Rotterdam heten we je van harte welkom bij deze videocast van One More Thing. We gaan het vandaag hebben over een bijzondere persoon uit de Apple-geschiedenis. Nee, het is niet Steve Jobs, het is ook niet Steve Wozniak. Het is een vrouw, namelijk Susan Kare. En Lucas, jij weet er meer over.
Ja, Susan Kare werd in begin jaren 80, in 1983 om precies te zijn, bij het Mac-team gehaald. Het Mac-team werkte aan de Macintosh die in 84 zou uitkomen. En Andy Hertzfeld, een belangrijk persoon ook in de geschiedenis van Apple, die haalde haar bij het Mac-team.
Andy Hertzfeld is een van de pioniers van Apple. Hij hoorde bij het originele Macintosh-team en hij heeft een boek geschreven over zijn ervaringen uit die tijd. Dat boek heet Revolutions in the Valley. Hij heeft ook een eigen site, folklore.org, waar hij uitgebreid praat over die geschiedenis. Tijdens de Macworld 2005 in San Francisco is hij ook te gast geweest bij recensent en schrijver David Polk. En daar gaan we je een stukje van laten zien.
So it's called folklore.org. I started working on it in the middle of 2003 with the goal of getting it live by the Mac's 20th birthday a year ago. I finished writing the stories in June of last year. And then it took about 2 or 3 months to turn it into a beautiful book.
And how has, you mentioned some of the other books were perhaps one-sided or self-serving. How has the reaction of the other team members been to this one?
It's been genuinely fantastic. In fact, we had a party for the book last night, and many of the original Mac team members were there. And I was moved by what some of them said, especially Bill Atkinson telling me he was so glad I wrote the book to finally get what he thinks is the real story out there. I felt a little bit funny, you know, just betraying the confidence of these experiences as well. And, you know, some of the things are appropriate to print, some are not. There's a lot of stories I self-censored. But we had one photograph, when I showed it to my editors, they said, this is the best photograph of all, you gotta put it in the book. And I decided not to. The story behind this is there's this character named Jean Pigozzi, a genuine jet setter. I think he's the grandson of the guy who founded the Renault Motor Company. He's a French guy. And characters like that were always hanging around Steve Jobs and consequently hanging around the Mac group. While we were in New York, we met with Pigozzi and he had an afternoon out on the town with Steve. And then we were supposed to go to dinner with him, but Steve got called away to something else. But Brol and I went with Pigozzi and he handed me, he says, oh, give this photo to Steve. This one I took this afternoon, I think he'll really like it.
Tot zover de eigen opname van Andy Hertzfeld. Gaan we terug naar Susan Kare. Ze werd in 83 bij Apple aangenomen. En haar taak was om icoontjes en fonts te maken voor het nieuwe systeem, de Macintosh. En dat was nog niet zo makkelijk, want het systeem of de beeldscherm van de Macintosh had een resolutie van 500 zoveel bij 300 zoveel. Dus het was erg lastig om op een hele kleine ruimte toch iets duidelijk weer te geven. Het is toch gelukt, want we kennen allemaal nu nog de cursor is van haar bijvoorbeeld. En het bommetje, het klokje, het handje ook. Je ziet ook nog de paint bucket, zien we nu ook nog terug in Photoshop. Dus het is al met al is het erg goed gelukt. En ook in de iPod kwamen haar font nog tegen, Chicago. Een van de fonts die ze gemaakt heeft voor het eerste systeem.
In 1985 verliet Susan Apple tegelijkertijd met Steve Jobs. Hij heeft haar meegenomen naar zijn nieuwe bedrijf Next Computer. En zij heeft daar ook grafische ontwerpen voor gemaakt. In 1998 had ze echter daar weer genoeg van. En is ze als zelfstandig grafische ontwerper gaan werken voor grote bedrijven als IBM, Intel, Sony en Motorola. En ze is zelfs verschenen op de langlijst van Microsoft. Want zij heeft de icoontjes ontworpen voor Microsoft Windows 3. En sterker nog, ook de kaarten van het spelletje Patience zijn door Susan ontworpen.
Kortom, Susan Kare is van groot belang geweest voor de Macintosh Group. Ze heeft een beetje het gezicht van de Macintosh gegeven. En we gaan nu in deze special edition van One More Thing kijken naar een uitzending van een televisieprogramma in Amerika. En het heet The Computer Chronicles. En in dit programma ging het vooral over computers en technologie. En in deze aflevering speciaal ging het over computerergonomie. Susan Kare gaat het daar eigenlijk helemaal niet over hebben. Want ze krijgt gewoon de gelegenheid van de presentatoren om Macintosh te showen. Je ziet de Macintosh op de tafel staan. En zij legt gewoon wat dingen uit. Allerlei programma's die daar allemaal in zitten. Daar gaan we dus nu naar kijken.
Joining us now is Susan Kerr. Susan is an icon designer with the Macintosh Software Group and Jerry Manick, who's product design manager for Macintosh. We're talking, Jerry, about ergonomics on this show. How did the Mac address some of the ergonomics problems we've been discussing?
There are certain basic design criteria that we use for keyboards, the angle of keyboards, the angle of the front screen of the Macintosh, taken out of the literature. We wanted Macintosh to be able to be used by the 99th percentile, male, female, also by, we knew that children would be using the Macintosh. That pretty much decided the arrangement of the tube above the disk drive slot. We wanted the keyboard to be very light, to be able to be moved around easily. Macintosh itself, we wanted the case to be as small as possible because it's a portable unit. We wanted a very strong statement of transportability, thus the handle on the top. We wanted the keyboard to be able to be easily connected and disconnected. The four wire coil cord plugs into the front of Macintosh to make it easy to assemble it. The disk drive is pretty unique, we think. We've gone away from the soft floppy disks that can be easily damaged with heat or bringing something magnetic close to it. This hard plastic shell on the disk drive, on the diskette, completely protects the media inside and can be used, carried in your pocket without worry about getting dirty or damaged. It also makes the disk drive very reliable in practically any climate. You can be assured that you won't lose data by using that.
Tell us about the mouse. That's obviously been a key part of Lisa and now Mac technology.
The mouse is a very efficient cursor pointing device. There have been a lot of studies about how the most efficient way to point the cursor is. Actually, the mouse is designed to be used all the way from a child to an adult with a very light touch on your hand. The early mice, even from Apple, had three buttons or two buttons on top. We worked very hard to get just the button to be a single button without having to have the person remember right or left, just click, and as Susan will show you later, the function is done.
Susan, you're an icon designer, among other things, and have you learned something from the experience on Lisa as to the effectiveness of icons, how to use them, and how they fit in?
Well, certainly, I think one of the best experiences is seeing a person who's never used a Lisa before or a Mac before, and even never used a computer before. It is possible, easily possible, to teach most people to use one of these computers in about 20 minutes. And a lot of that is because you can explain what an icon means and a person can remember it easily. So we certainly use Lisa as a jumping off point and making just some refinements and additions for some new features.
Okay, your area, the icons, are another one of the key ergonomic aspects, I suppose, of using a Mac. Maybe you can run through a demonstration here, Susan, and show us how we use the icons to get from place to place. Tell us where we are right at this moment with Mac.
Well, what you see now is the image, the icon that you get when you just plug Mac in and turn it on. It prompts you with a picture of the diskette. So you've
and a question mark saying, where's my diskette?
Saying, I need something.
Okay, so
that all you do is, it only fits in one way, so there's no way you can break it or make a mistake. You just pop it in. You get an image of a content Mac, so you know that everything is okay. And you're welcomed. It's just so that the person using Mac gets information all the time, visually, so nothing has to be translated. A little wristwatch to tell you, just wait 1 second.
Things are happening. You've replaced the salt timer.
Yeah. We're moving into the 80s.
So what do we have now?
So what we have now is an image on the screen of the diskette that we put in the slot. And it can be with the mouse, it can be moved.
Okay. And it's already showing you the name of that disk.
Right. And it's highlighted in the sense that it's inverted, so that Mac knows that you want to do something to this diskette, and your choices of what you might want to do are listed in hidden menus that operate a little bit like window shades when you move your cursor.
So let's pull down the file menu to see. That would tell us now what?
Right, that our choices, we could find out something about this diskette, or we can just open it, or we could eject it. But if we open it, just say open, and immediately you get what we call a window that displays graphically and in words what is contained on the diskette in the machine. So you can see there's a picture of a hand painting, which symbolizes a paint program, and a hand writing for the word processor, and a couple of memos that were already written, some folders. If, say, you want to store a document or two in a folder, it's analogous to life. You just put the piece of paper in the folder.
Now, you've got something called the control panel here. Show me what that is.
Always available to you are a number of desk accessories. So you move the cursor to the control panel, let go of the mouse button.
And what do we have?
So this, which looks a little bit like a dashboard, lets you fine-tune the system in a number of ways to your comfort level, or just your personal preferences. The computer will work no matter what settings. So that,
such as, what controls do you have?
Say, here's a little volume control. You can see the speaker. So every now and then you hear a beep with Mac when you turn it on, or sometimes during applications. If you're at home by yourself and you're listening to the stereo, you might want to know that you'll always hear those beeps. Mm-hmm. If you're a student working in the library, you can move it so that just the bar will flash, so there's no noise at all. Say, some of the other features let you adjust keyboard repeat rate, or a menu flash, or the amount of time between double clicks, which might vary with the age of the person using the
computer. I'm going to rush you, because I want to see as much of this as we can in the time we have. Show me Notepad and how that works.
We can pop the control panel away by just clicking on it. And Notepad lets you, while you're working in any application, as well as just this, what we call the Finder, which is like a directory, mm-hmm. be able to grab the keyboard and write a note to yourself. Remember to read page 12. And you could say, put this away, or you could move it over.
Show me how you flip the pages of the notepad. That's kind of impressive.
We can go to page 2, where it says another note, one left for oneself. Flip to page 3, up to 8 pages of notes that could help you in your work or just remind you of social events.
One of the items was scrapbook.
Right. Scrapbook lets you keep literally, you're only up to 256. You're only limited by how much memory you have free. Pictures or messages or documents always available for the terms we use are cutting and pasting.
Maybe you can go to Mac Write, and then we could build up to how you'd use that.
Right. So, say, to open a word processor application, you could click on Mac Write and say open. If you want to get right to a document, which automatically launches the application, same procedure, which is why it's easy to use.
And now you're loading the word processing.
We're loading the word processor and the specific document that
I think one of the advantages too of Macintosh is that things happen so quickly. It certainly fits into the ergonomic pattern of the user interacting quickly with the device.
It's just very direct. No complicated sequence of commands to remember. We can. Here's an old little bit of sample text. This is how the word processor appears to you. A ruler lets you set formats, which is certainly a familiar object. Say you want to go from single to double space, just click on the wider image if you want.
And you can justify or center. We're not going to have time, actually, but you could have pulled up pictures from Mac Paint from the scrapbook and then insert them into the document.
Paste them in just by saying paste from the menu. If you want to change a word to be bold, just say bold. Change the font to something like Old English.
Okay, I know you're having fun, Susan, but I'm going to have to stop.
It's hard when it's your baby not to be enthusiastic.
I get the feeling. Well, thanks so much for showing off Mac to us, and thanks for joining us on this edition of the Computer Chronicles.
Dat was Susan Kerr meer dan 20 jaar geleden in The Computer Chronicles. Nou, het mag duidelijk zijn. Susan Kerr is een bijzondere, maar ook vooral een hele belangrijke persoon geweest in de geschiedenis van de Apple Macintosh. Haar ontwerpers zijn tot en met de dag van vandaag duidelijk herkenbaar. Niet alleen bij Apple, maar ook bijvoorbeeld bij Windows. Dit was One More Thing, een podcast en deze keer een videocast van macOSX.nl. Heb jij opmerkingen, verzoekjes of ander commentaar? Mail dat dan naar podcast@macOSX.nl. Bedankt voor het kijken en tot de volgende keer.